What is privacy if it's not a recognition of individual autonomy? And individual autonomy is most needed for people who have historically lacked it, who have suffered under the paternal yoke. And talk more about it. We have today with us Nayantara. Nayantara is a researcher and lawyer interested in politics and culture of technologies. She works at the Internet Democracy Projects on programs related to free expression, surveillance, net neutrality. She has conceptualized and executed with a colleague the program on gendering surveillance, a project on exposing the gendered nature of surveillance in the Indian context. But much more recently, what I've really benefited from her work is AdWatch, where there is a visual representation of how advertisements were actually purchased on social media networking platforms and the impact they had on democracy. So to hear more on how this privacy interact with gender, and let's hear it from Nayantara.
So I think the fights of gender and sexual minorities can in a way be thought of as a fight for visibility. So whether this is in the eyes of the law or whether it is representation in our cultural lives, in cinema, etc., or whether it is like the language that is used in newspapers, etc., it can be thought of as a kind of fight for visibility on the one hand. But on the other end of the spectrum, it is also a fight against increased monitoring and surveillance of bodies and lives. So you can see this whether it is like something like the stairs in the street or the kind of security apparatus that is designed for cisnormative bodies in the airports or violence at the hands of the police. So if you look at these two conditions of one of the lack of visibility on the one end of the spectrum and a hyper visibility on the other end of the spectrum, what differentiates one from the other is the fact of choice in the matter. And what Puttaswamy judgment does is really affirm the existence of such autonomy to take decisions about our bodies, minds, and our lives. And Puttaswamy, of course, draws this inextricable link between the right to privacy and to human dignity. But this liberal notion of autonomy might not take us very far because not all of us have the same, not all of us are able to exercise it in the same way because we are located in different situations and circumstances and experiences. So although bodies are central to surveillance, the access to some bodies have been always traditionally easier than to other bodies. And this can be on the basis of gender, this can be on the basis of caste, this can be on the basis of the status of occupation of territory, sexuality, and so on. So for example, when it comes to the question of autonomy of using laws against sexual harassment at the workplace, someone that is a domestic worker at a house might not have the same level of autonomy to exercise it as someone at a law firm with a different level of access to resources. So as we think about the Puttaswamy judgment and the fact that it has emerged from the challenges to Aadhaar, it is important to look at debates beyond the data protection sphere, but what's also important is not to make this sphere of the internet and data-related rights as if it is something exceptional, as if it is something new and mysterious, because this kind of exceptionality benefits a certain kind of people and basically does not allow us to have a more historically loaded conversations that draws from the experiences and knowledge in different movements. So to understand who's able to enjoy the fruits of the Puttaswamy judgment and going forward, we should look at legislations that are coming up outside of the data sphere. So to give an example, in the trans bill that was passed by the Lok Sabha this July, it's supposed to cater to the needs of the trans people, but what it actually in fact does is entrench a totally different expectation of privacy in the lives of trans persons. So by requiring a totally dehumanizing and violent process of identification, the bill subjects trans persons to an institutionalized kind of hypervisibility that cis people might not even fathom having to go through. Similarly, the trafficking bill, which in the name of increased protection to trafficking victims and this ever attractive idea of prevention, creates easier access to certain bodies, to certain workplaces, to certain homes and lives of people than in comparison to others. So these are just two examples of sites where there is a baseline shift in the expectation of privacy itself. So apart from paying attention to how priorities for surveillance is being shaped, that is, who is of interest, whose lives are meant to be more monitored, who is considered a valued member of society, I think there's also lessons to be drawn from the feminist movement, from queer movements, from anti-caste movements, and other movements around us. Because it wasn't so long ago that it wasn't just the law, but even science deemed queer people unfit for society. So these histories kind of help us question the construction of science as this the objectivity of science as a field itself, and its newer cousin of data science as being this objective truth teller amongst us. So going forward, we should draw from the wisdom in these movements and look at the dangers of increasing securitization around us, and look at the dangers of the state as this benevolent patriarch. So in the name of prevention, in the name of more security, in the name of more safety, what are the rights that are being lost, and who is this most affecting? Thank you.